you ever get that feeling that the internet is just broken? You know, what started as this wide open frontier now feels more like a maze of walled gardens, endless ads, and constant surveillance. Well, today, we're going to dig into a blueprint, the Qortal blueprint, for a totally different kind of internet, one built on the simple but powerful idea of just cutting out the middlemen. All right, so here's the game plan. First, we'll talk about why the internet feels like it's getting worse. Then, we'll get into the real problem, centralization. From there, we'll check out a totally different way of thinking, see how it actually works in the real world, and finish up by asking, what if we just got rid of the middlemen for good? All right, section one. Is the internet really getting worse? I mean, it kind of feels like we traded this wide open frontier for a bunch of walled gardens, right? I think a lot of us feel this. You know, you're just trying to do something simple, watch a video, read an article, and it feels like you're in a fight, a constant battle against pop-ups, trackers, and those ads you just can't skip. The whole experience is just degrading. And, you know, this quote from a creator just nails it. It's become this arms race, this endless cat and mouse game between the platforms and their own users. And let's be honest, the user experience is always the one that loses. It really does get kind of stoop. And yeah, the list of complaints is probably pretty familiar to all of us. It's not just that there are too many ads, it's that we're now getting ads and services we pay for. Think about that. And it's not just bad content anymore, it's this scammy AI-generated sludge that's just clogging up everything. All while in the background, our data is being vacuumed up and platforms are literally throttling videos if you have the nerve to use an ad blocker. So here's the thing. All of these frustrations, they're not separate problems. They're all symptoms of one single core issue. And that brings us to our second section, the centralization problem. According to the sources we're looking at, the reason the internet feels so broken is because a tiny number of massive companies have quietly taken over. And to really get a sense of how much control we're talking about, just look at the web traffic. The data shows that just two companies, Google's parent Alphabet and Meta, control a whopping 70% of all online activity. 70%. Pretty much everything you see, everything you click, has to pass through their gates first. Okay, so how do they pull this off? Well, a huge part of it is something called the DNS, or the domain name system. Think of it like the internet's phone book. And here's the catch, it's highly centralized. That means you don't really own your website or your online name, you're just renting it. And that lease can be canceled pretty much whenever they want. And look, this isn't some what-if scenario, this is real. Back in 2010, the US government seized 82 different domain names in one day. No trial, just gone. Because the central bodies that control those domains were under their jurisdiction, they could just flip the off switch. And this whole concentration of power, it just feeds on itself. It's what the source material calls a virtuous cycle. Well, virtuous for the company anyway. More users equals more data. They use that data to make their products stickier, more addictive. That brings in even more users, which means even more data. It's a flywheel that just spins faster and faster, sucking all the power to the center. Okay, so if centralization is the disease, what's the cure? That brings us to section three, a totally different way of looking at things. This goes all the way back to the original cypherpunk vision for the web, and that was all about using powerful encryption to give power back to individuals, protecting our privacy and freedom from these huge central powers. Now, we all hear the term Web3 thrown around, right? But the source material makes a really important distinction here. There are kind of two versions of it. You got the hype version, the one backed by venture capital, full of ICOs, and, ironically, often still running on centralized servers like Amazon's. It's all about speculation. But then you have this other vision, the cypherpunk one, and that's what we're looking at here. We're talking no VCs, a totally fair launch, building its own decentralized infrastructure from the ground up, and focusing on actual utility, not just hype. And this vision, it's built on some really core non-negotiable ideas. First, everything is 100% open source. The whole point is to have zero middlemen. And get this, it's designed so that anyone can help secure the network, even with a tiny computer like a Raspberry Pi. And this is a big one. It was a fair launch. No insiders, no pre-mine, no VCs getting a head start. It's all designed from the ground up to be impossible to censor. Okay, that all sounds great on paper, but how does this stuff actually work? Let's get into it. Section 4, decentralization in action. All right, let's circle back to one of those frustrations we talked about at the very beginning. Remember that? Platforms are literally using AI to stick ads right in the most engaging moments of a video. I mean, that's the perfect example of a system where the platform's goals, getting more ad views, are completely at odds with what the creator and the viewer want. So let's do a direct comparison. The mainstream model. The platform is driven by ads. The creator gets, what, about 55% of that? You're constantly being tracked, and there's always the risk of being deplatformed or censored. Now let's look at the alternative.
Keep in mind, YouTube, which is just one app on Qortal among many that provide services.
Here, there are no ads, no corporate monetization. Creators get 100% of any tips they receive. There is absolutely zero data tracking, and because of how it's built, the content is permanent and uncensorable. So you're probably wondering, how do creators make money then? Well, it's through this super-like model. It's super simple. You watch a video you like, and you can attach a small tip right to your comment. And here's the kicker. The creator gets 100% of that tip. And this whole no middleman philosophy isn't just about video. The source material lays out an entire ecosystem built on the same foundation. We're talking e-commerce, where sellers don't pay any platform fees, crowdfunding, where every single dollar goes to the project, and even peer-to-peer file sharing. It's the whole shebang. Okay, so let's zoom out for our last section and look at the big picture. What does it really mean to have an internet without any middlemen? When you put them side by side, the difference is just fundamental. In the middleman economy we have now, you're paying high fees, your data is the product they sell, censorship is just a part of the business model, and you're basically just renting your spot online. But in this peer-to-peer world,
more specifically, the Qortal ecosystem,
those platform fees, they're gone. You control your data, censorship isn't just frowned upon, it's built to be impossible. And you go from just renting to having real, true ownership. It's a complete shift from being a user to being an owner. And really, it all boils down to this one final question. If we can actually build systems where we can all exchange value, data, and content directly with each other, with no one in the middle taking a cut, no one setting the rules, then what role is left for the giants of today's internet? What happens to them? It's a question that really gets to the core of what the web could be, and it's definitely something to chew on.